Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Ganesh, for the illustrious five trains that you talked about in terms of how things would be moving. I think you echoed the voice that we saw in the morning. Let me start off by talking about a very quick thing on three aspects. Somebody in the morning talked about why are we only looking at post-harvest. If you look at Government of India, it is not only post-harvest that the government is looking at. We are starting with input side, whether it's fertilizers or whether it's soil health card, something that you must have been hearing a lot about. So it's starting at that level. Then you are getting into at the time of transaction where national agriculture market is in the process of being making, and if technology becomes a disruptive force, you would see a lot, not exactly GCMF kind of a story, but closer to that, because they are something that you see that the producer gets around 80% of the overall final value. Today in agriculture commodities, you have farmers getting around 35% to the best in terms of requirements. So the moment technology becomes a disruptive force and there are things happening on that side, things will happen. The third aspect was on the warehousing side, and that's where the post-harvest discussions were happening in the morning also, and now also we are going to discuss on that. So I'll not take much time in terms of talking about snapshot, because I guess snapshot has been discussed a lot by our speakers earlier. So let me just quickly talk about a few things. One that I wanted to talk about, that warehousing as such is going to have much, much higher demand going forward. And there are different pillars which are going to pull them. There are demand triggers which are there, including whether it's National Food Security Act, whether it's better monsoon, whether it's other factors that I've listed down here. We will see not only 4 to 6%, if things go right, it may be towards a double digit type of thing that we'll see going forward. So that's one trend quickly we can look at. The second thing was, within that, I think in the morning also we talked about, so I'll just take this one more slide on the cold storage side, that cold storage as such also for perishable goods is going to increase substantially, and that is going to increase at a much higher rate than what we see warehouses increase, the other commodity warehouses increasing. And therefore, these two that we will see. What is also important to see here is that around 90% of this cold storage is in terms of warehouses, and around 10 to 11% is what we see in terms of vehicle, in terms of transportation. Both are expected to increase further, especially on the vehicle side. Let me not spend much time and come back to the topic of the session, which is in terms of the regulatory aspects related to warehousing. And let me start off by getting into the history and just listing down as to what happened in terms of the regulatory framework that we have evolved. So we start with, if you go back in the history, the whole idea started with 1928, from where the Royal Commission talked about establishment of licensed warehouses. Then we went to 1954 and 1956, where there were discussions on creating warehouses, and that's where the first act in 1956 came in. And then you had 1962, where warehousing corporation came in, therefore the government getting into the warehousing business came into the picture. And then you have a whole host of things happening, different states coming out of with warehousing acts, which I have not listed here. Then at the national level, again, in around 2000 was another landmark thing where you had national policy on storage, transportation, and food grains came in. And then 2007, you had these warehousing acts. 2008, PEG, Gramin Rojgar Yojana, not exactly the acts, but some things which do impact warehousing and warehouse regulation in different ways, due to policy interventions, due to programs, and things like that. And therefore, they need to be mentioned here. And of course, in the morning also, we have been discussing about GST as well as the other acts like 100%, other policy interventions like 100% FDI and state acts, which would again impact the warehousing business as such in terms of their locations and profitability and things and like that. And therefore, they also need to be taken into account when we talk about regulations. If we look at a snapshot as of today, what we will find is in the ecosystem of regulation, we'll have WRDA 2007. We will also have the other acts like Essential Commodities Act, MSP, banking regulations, and so on and so forth, which I have listed here, which I also talked about in the previous slide. Essentially saying that it is not only Warehousing Act itself or WRDA or one SEBI coming into picture, and these are the only two. There are other enough sufficient number of acts which are also working or will be a factor to be considered by warehouses or warehousing operating firms in this direction. Right, so when we talk about regulatory convergence, we need to take into account all these acts, regulations, policies, program interventions which are going to come into picture, and the future. As we saw in the morning, the future of warehouse that I could see in the morning was foldable warehouses. Everyone comes up, sets up their own warehouses, right? So to that extent is where our regulations should then go forward and should be able to relate to that kind of a intervention. Let me talk about then what is it that we look into a regulator, and therefore then come to how do we go about this convergence. Some of the things that we will find if we go through literature, if we talk to people, if we talk to regulator, and in fact one of the matured regulators, SEBI, also talked about in terms of development of markets, so it's not only regulation. So let me talk about some of the things. One, the most important thing is wherever you could maximize the potential of voluntary compliance, because that ensures that in the whole system you create minimum dead weight. You are able to ensure least amount of cost in the whole regulation process if you are able to do that. Then use risk analysis to identify the areas which are intrinsically adverse impacts or possible low compliances. So focus on those low compliances areas where there are risks, regulate them, find ways of managing them, whether with different kind of interventions. Range of instrument, enforcement instruments to be used in order to be able to do that. Then another important aspect is to be able to apply regulation across different sectors and across different industries types, across different businesses, across different grain types. That will make it more of homogeneous kind of a thought process. Then also another important thing would be to have a continuous dialogue with the government and business community in terms of what are the key challenges and how do we go about looking at them. And then monitor the compliances, of course, least to say that. Then let me come to, then if those are the good regulators, then what is it that I need to regulate? And if you ask some of the academicians, including Professor Raghuram, you will get to hear that there are six things that we need to regulate. License, safety, price, service level, environmental impact, and dispute resolution. These are the six dimensions on which, in any commodity, we go about regulating it. That's first work that regulator has to do. The second it has to do is to create an ecosystem where the stakeholders promote market-based regulation, where we are able to create capacity, where we are able to share and disseminate information as well. This is very important to be able to ensure the first best regulator's activity, where we said market-based self-regulation should be able to do that. Only if you have all the stakeholders who are far more aware. And that's something that you heard in the morning also, SEBI saying that I don't want to only regulate, I want to develop this area, I want to develop the ecosystem. And therefore, that's very important. Where should I regulate? There are different stages in case of warehousing if we talk about, whether it's acquisition, construction, or lease of warehousing, whether it's at the operation stage of the warehousing, whether it's distribution, which is in-out transport part of warehousing, whether it's closing of warehousing for various reasons, whether it's cost economics, where it's a strategic decision, and so on and so forth. And of course, the last would be to monitor the compliance. Now, who are the key regulators? And I have just listed a few in the warehousing sector as of now. It is WDRA, State Warehousing, SEBI, through exchange as per their latest paper where they talk about that through exchange is which will regulate the commodity movement, commodity futures. Then the other provisions which are including food safety, hoarding, and things like that, which I talked about in the earlier slide in terms of the different acts where you can't do hoarding as well. Now, let's come to each one of those six aspects and see how best can we try and get the regulatory convergence. What we need to do is to understand in license or registration, what is it that is to be licensed? Is it warehouse? Is it the owner who needs to have a license, a good conduct or a good director? Or is it the operator? Or in our WRDA terms, it would be warehouseman or the warehouse service provider, whichever way we refer it in SEBI's words. Right? What is it that I need to register? Do I need to register all three? Do I need to register one? If we need to register three, let us define who is going to register it at one place, not at different places. For example, in the case of airport, you don't have to have only one regulator, right? In case of airport, you have multiple regulators. Somebody is looking at safety, somebody is looking at aircraft maintenance, somebody is looking at air navigation, all of them have different. Somebody is looking at revenue, AER, right? So similarly, if you want here also, let's look at what is to be licensed and let's have whoever is the most pertinent for whichever purpose, let's have it there. Or let's have it at one place, say WDRA, others providing input. So SEBI saying that, okay, for the purposes of exchanges which are going to be there, these are the stringent criteria that need to have. Similarly, who is eligible to be registered? Is it an individual? Is it a legal entity? Is it an incorporated body corporate? What is the minimum turnover? What is the minimum net worth or liquidity ratio? These are the differences that you find across different regulators for the reasons that they have different sets of requirements. Now, what we could do is to converse them together, put at one place and say for specific requirements, like if you are not going for anything like warehouse-based receipts, negotiable warehouse-based receipt, then you will need minimum of, say, 25 lakhs or 50 lakhs as it mandated today. If you go for this, then you need to have a net worth of 50 crore or so on and so forth. Now, why don't we do that at one place? That's convergence is quite possible. And all these aspects from different regulators' point of view could be covered and brought in together. Similarly, let me come to the second aspect, which is safety. Safety could be looked at different ways, and I have taken a little broader understanding of safety, including at the construction stage. Today, we have three different norms, say BIS, FCI, or CWC specifications. Now, these specifications could still be there, and we could define that for a particular purpose, if you want to issue negotiable instruments, you have to be at least CWC compliant, that level of specification, or minimum of this specification. Just being not having that kind of a specification does not give you that liberty of being able to be registered for this purpose. So you could still operate in the market, but you will have restricted access to different kinds of facilities that you could provide or different kind of activities that you could perform in that market. Then we come to accreditation. Now, for accreditation purpose, again, different agencies are coming up with different guidelines. You already have WDRA coming up with one set of guidelines. There are accreditation agencies on the website of WDRA, and some of them have already, their licenses have expired. They haven't, haven't renewed their licenses as yet. SEBI has come out with another paper where they talk about a certain way in which exchanges should regulate and minimum requirement of these accreditation agencies. So can we try and converse them together and put them together with what should be the minimum qualification? Similar would be the case of minimum accreditation requirements of warehouses could be different for negotiable warehouses received versus non-negotiable warehouses received. In fact, one important example here would be to also talk about the national agriculture market, which we have been talking about. In fact, I had the privilege of working on that project and conceptualizing it as a part of the government scheme, where we looked at very similar kind of a challenge you have. Every place you have a different way of how producers and sellers view quality of grains. Now, when you have an electronic market where a Delhi-based guy is going to buy something in Mumbai or Mumbai-based person is going to buy from Chennai, you need to have quality standards across. So the suggestion was then to move out of these gradings of A, B, C, fair quality and this and that, and let's get into assaying, which is far more scientific. Say, these are physical properties, these are chemical properties, these are XYZ properties, and therefore, now you decide how do you want to go. It will take a little bit of time to mature, but the market will mature. Why not use the same thing for here as well? Why the same continuum could be brought in here, in both accreditation as well as assaying and quality monitoring purposes. Similarly, insurance, I think we had a very good session, so I don't want to get a little more into it. However, one has to look at what kind of insurances have to be taken. Different people have asked for it, and you already had all these discussions, so let's move in the interest of time. Similarly, in terms of audit, now whether the audit requirements for these warehouses, do we need to change auditors every 3 years? SEBI says yes, the other regulation says is silent. So can we have that, okay, if you are issuing issuing negotiable receipts, then yes, in 3 years, otherwise you don't have to, and things like that. So there is a quite bit of possibility of being able to converge and reduce the risk that we have, the cost that exist across different regulators and duplicity of regulations that exist. Similarly, in terms of the service level, what is the minimum quality standards for various things, timely delivery of deposits, regulation related to temperature or controlled environment. Today, it is being said that the exchange should also ensure that the warehouses are managing these at a certain particular environment, because that, in a way, impacts the quality and, therefore, the price of the goods which are there. Can we not have these accreditation agencies going a little more at a periodic interval, which is lesser than for non-perishable goods, and be able to check that and come back, rather than these exchanges themselves going and doing it or getting it done separately? So there is a bit of convergence that we could see. The aim is there, and then we need to converge them together. Similarly, in terms of pricing, how do we go about looking at differentiating price for a marginal or a small farmer, and then look at what are the other market failures that could happen, and do we need to regulate in terms of leasing cost if necessary? Similarly, environmental impact, not too much in the agriculture unless rodents and others become an environmental concern going forward to save them. As of now, they don't seem to be. The last would be in terms of the dispute resolution, where we will have to look at if depositor or farmer or investor or warehouse service providers have certain disputes with each other or with certain policymakers or with some other agencies like funding agencies and things like that, then what is the action that needs to be done? So these are the six pillars on which we need to look at, and there is a sufficient amount of synergy that we see where there are differences which can be conversed together, brought together, and we could see that. Very quickly, a few things that we could immediately do. One was to look at removing multiplicity of accreditation or registration rules and regulations, common standards for SAing, warehouses to be seen more as mandi. For example, Karnataka has done that, and Punjab has done to some extent in terms of silos. Let's look at doing it across the place, and then therefore one has to work with state APMCs, something which has been done in terms of creating NAM. The government did work, central government, with all the state governments which had APMC Act and got them modified to include three necessary clauses, which has not done earlier in the past. So therefore, it's possible to do that. It only needs more of a mission mode of a discussion. Work with the state government to consider silos, warehouses, we talked about. Then exempt these commodities under the Essential Commodities Act. And then look at if there are certain challenges, how can we resolve those challenges which can come because of this issue. In fact, it won't come, because now you will have an information which is far more available in terms of who is holding, who is keeping how much of quantity where. It will be far more transparent. So holding issues shouldn't be there, in fact. And therefore, this exemption could be looked at. Similarly, modern technology is something that we talked about. Insurance, there was one issue which was talked about also in terms of pricing. Probably you could look at creating in the short term also some kind of a indemnity fund if required, because if the insurance in certain particular areas are not available today or there is not sufficient information available, then probably in the short term, while data comes in, you could look at that fund taking care of it, especially in case of warehousing receipts being negotiable. Last would be, and foremost importance would be, to look at capacity building or training for all stakeholders, because that would lead to what we talked about, the first principle in ensuring maximum voluntarily support from all of them. So this is what I would like to quickly talk about in terms of the way we should try and look at regulatory convergence and try and achieve that.
Now, thanks a lot, Satyam. Thanks a lot.